It is a great day the Lord has made, and we will what?
Rejoice.
And be glad in it, even to that. Okay, that's a mindset. That's a decision we made. And that one was certainly under the Lord. So we welcome all of you, and we look forward to the time that we share together today. Of course, different ones of us have been asked to open the service, and I've been asked to do that, and I've been given all the instructions right here in this piece of paper, so we'll try to get through that. Okay. Want to remind, we have some guests here today. We're grateful that you've chosen to be a part of our church family, at least for today. And you're aware we're going to have the communion service here in a little bit, and that's open communion. You're welcome to share with us as we remember the Lord. Just ask that you examine your heart before Him, and feel free to join us in that. There's a connection card in the back of the hymnal rack. Fill that out if you would like, and be a record of your participation here today. I want to remind you that next Sunday, we'll only have one service, and that will be at 9 o'clock, it says, followed by the brunch and the annual meeting of our church family. So please be in prayer about that as we select some leaders. There's a copy of the annual report on the back table. Take that with you. Read it through this week. Be prepared to share in that meeting then on next Lord's Day. If you cannot be here and would still like to be a part of casting your vote, there's some absentee ballots there on that table. Please feel free to take one of those and use that. And the pizza making crew are set to go. Today is the last day to put in your orders. So if you'd like to order some of those pizzas and help out the various missions here at the church, you can do that. And they will be closing out the ordering, and then they got to buy all the ingredients and put them together here coming up. Was that next Saturday? I believe it is. Okay, that'll be on next Saturday, so they might need some help doing that. Again, we have a prayer shawl today, and it's for Bonnie Tully, age 48, if I'm reading this correctly. She's had cancer, but now has been diagnosed with lung cancer, and the surgery is Tuesday. And her dad is Dennis Lell. That might make a connection if any of you know him. So that's a prayer request for us today. Also, we were notified this morning that Arlene Boffman passed away. Many of you know her. Just last summer, down at Christian Harbor, she and her husband Harold celebrated their 75th wedding anniversary. And they're both up in their 90s. And so they've been living in Chippewa Falls at a special facility for aging people. And we were notified about her passing, and they wanted us to let you folks know. Today we have a guest, as you're all aware, Don Hunt, part of the Gateway Singers. We were, not that the elders didn't want to preach, any more Sundays, but I mentioned to Lynn, I said, why don't we have the Gateways come up one of these Sundays when we're in between preachers? Oh, he said, that's a good idea. Well, the whole crew couldn't come, unfortunately, but Don is here to share with us today, and we've been supporting them as a church family for many years, and we're glad to have him. But however, please understand, he came and he said to me, Russ, he said, I caught a cold from my grandkids. So his voice is a little on the upside, but on the downside. But you'll be able to give the message. We'll hear his voice and hear his heart as he shares his music. And we will be receiving a special love offering for Don and his ministry, and it's called Relief Ministry. I'll mention this at the end of service again. There'll be the offering box there at the back for them. But the ministry that Don works with is called Relief Ministries. And Relief is an acronym for another thought. And you're going to have that on the slides later. Okay. Just be anticipating that, okay? I would share it with you, but I've asked you three times already what it is. And I can't remember. But so that's what's happening to me. But anyway, You'll look forward to that. And so, without anything further, let's just pray, and Don will come and share with us. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for every day. And as we have quoted that verse of Scripture, this is a day you've made. We'll be glad. We'll rejoice in it. Today especially, we give praise and honor as a church family as we come together. Help us to encourage one another, to support one another, to love one another. And Father, in so doing, honor your word and give glory to you. Thank you for the Gateway Singers, their ministry over the years, and their faithfulness. And we pray, Father, for Don as he shares today. May it be an encouragement to us, and again, may it be pleasing to you. So we commit this time to you and to your Son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. The scripture says, "See what great love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God." So let's sing about his great love. Love lifted me. Excuse me, shall we dance?
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the water lifted in the Savior.
Here I am to say that you're my God.
You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
We cry, holy, holy,
mighty God in heaven, we come today to worship you, to bow down our hearts, our heads, to you, the creator of all, the sustainer of all. Thank you as your Son came to this earth, lived a holy, pure, holy life, was willing to lay that life down so that we too might become like him, pure, clean, holy. Thank you for this supreme sacrifice, this willingness to set us the example of how to live, how to serve, how to die with you. In Jesus' name we pray.
We fall down, we lay on our crown, our defeat. Jesus, the greatness of his mercy and love, I believe. Oh, Jesus, we cry.
Since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on to love, toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. And if we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fear and expectation of judgment in the raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy at the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think a man deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of a covenant that sanctified him, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay." And again, "The Lord will judge his people." It is a dreadful thing to fall in the hands of the living God. Remember those earlier days after you received the light when you stood your ground in the great contest in the face of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution, and other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You sympathized with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded.
You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a very little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one will live by faith. And if he shrinks back, I will not be pleased with him. And then these closing words, but we are not of those who shrink back and are destroyed, but of those who believe and are saved. We pray. Thank you, Lord, for this time of worship and praise. Thank you, Father, for the sending of your Son. Thank you, Father, for the sacrifice you made as the Lamb of God without sin. Thank you, Father, for the death he was willing to endure. And Father, thank you for the hope and the promise that we have in him. So we share together in communion. We partake of the loaf together as a picture under his broken and bruised body. We drink of the cup together as a testimony of our faith, and also, Father, the remembrance of the blood that was shed. And we're grateful, Father, that you have made a way. Thank you, Father, for your love, your grace, your mercy to us. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Let's softly sit together as the communion passes.
All that he can do, Father, the way is to serve.
Lord, we just thank you so much for the blessings you have given us individually and to this church. Lord, I just ask you bless the gift that we're about to receive this moment. I'm just blessed to possess your holy name. Amen.
Greetings from the Gateway Singers. I was the only one free to get up here this weekend. So you have to put up with the quieter part of the group. I don't say a whole lot. And I don't get to do this very often, but I enjoy it. Peace is what you want. That's what God brings to your heart and your life. Sailing on the journey, one dark stormy night, the disciples on board that ship were filled with fear and affright. But Jesus surely showed them winds and waves obey his will, for he quickly calmed them when he whispered, medical word is hemiparesis. Hemi means hemisphere is one half, Tammy Priest's midget's half paralyzed on the left side. This side doesn't function anymore. It just is. Doesn't feel. It just is. You ever leave the dentist? You know that feeling that it's about 50 miles that way? Yeah, that's just the way it is with me. Probably if I started to feel now, it would hurt. Because I haven't felt it for so long. We were in Nashville, Tennessee, making one of our recordings. And about 9 o'clock at night, I went out to take a swim. Got on the end of a diving board, 10 feet of water, and went into the water feet first. Went to the bottom of the pool, I got a crouch position. Pushed up as hard as I could to get out of the water. My goal was to come up like to my waist, just to see if I could do it. As I shot into the water, it fell on my head, exploded, literally. Got off to the side, I thought, you know, something's happened. I don't know what's happened. I don't feel right. I sat on the pool with my feet over the edge and dangling in the water. I had our two young boys, they were 2 and 3 years old, sitting on my car hood outside the pool fence. And I had told the boys I'm just going to jump in once more because they were getting kind of restless. Then that happened. When I got out, I told the boys, I said, no, feel well, I got to go get some help. Somebody will come out and get you. Got right in front of the checkout counter at the hotel. I began to throw up, but I caught it and I ran out and collapsed in a strip of grass about as wide as this aisle. Doing the parking lot and sidewalk. Next thing I knew, a lady was walking across the parking lot with those two little guys, one in each hand. Do you know who these kids are? I said, yeah, they're mine. I don't feel well. Can you go up and get some help? And I gave her the room number. And the next thing, they took me to a hospital. And the doctors looked at me and they said, you have a pressure headache. They were so right, but so wrong. They just gave me a bottle of pain pills and sent me back to the hotel. That was on a Tuesday. On a Friday, we went back to the studio. And if you know anything about me, I have a lot of grit. The group said, you're not going to go sing. I said, well, that's why I came. So they took me and they put me in a chair with a pillow, lowered the microphone down on a stand. And we finished the other half of that particular album and then Hospital 2. Different one. Guess what? Same diagnosis. Pressure headache. Gave me pain pills. Our next stop was in Louisville, Kentucky on tour. And there they took me to a chiropractor and she popped my neck and did all kinds of things, thinking I might have a pinched nerve or something. Next morning the fever was like 104. Took me to the hospital, 3. And they told me I had spinal meningitis after 6 hours. Dumped me in isolation, then they took a spinal tap and they found blood in the spinal fluid. So I knew I had a hemorrhage somewhere in the cranial area. And within 2 hours or so after that, I became paralyzed following a test where they took a picture of my brain and they didn't find one. It's there. But they also found a little bubble on the artery called an aneurysm. And when it bled, mine bled twice. The second time is when the paralysis came. You know, God is good to each of us. And you're looking at a miracle to be vertical, standing, walking, talking, thinking, singing, able to raise my family. In life, you might want to write this down. You have to count your blessings and not your bruises. We've all had a few of those. We've all had many, many blessings as well. God is so good. That script could have ended a whole lot different. I can't tell you how many times somebody has told me about a family member, a neighbor, a child that had the same thing and they aren't. Indeed, I am blessed. I count it a blessing to be a witness for him. How many of you have a right hand? Put it up in the air. You're going to take my talk home today with your right hand. So I'm going to ask you to do several things. You'll be proactive today. One of those is I want you to talk to me. I know that the preacher doesn't usually want you to talk, but today the rules have changed. So do this. 5, two, come on, let's do it. Five, two, like in on you. Five, two, two. Five, two, two. Psalms 55:22. Psalms 55:22. It simply says this, cast all your care on him, for he cares for you. He has never once let the righteous fall. Look me straight in the eye. You are a human being. You are not a superhuman being. God did not design you to carry a burden. You can do it for a while, and you'll succeed. But if you do it very long, you will crash. God designed you to let him carry the burden, the load. I insisted on carrying mine for quite a while. Things just didn't work. I lost my hair. Maybe that was going to happen anyway. I don't know. I've tried super glue shampoo, and nothing works. Just waves goodbye. You've heard the old saying, it used to be waves, but it's gone to beach. That's it right there. I see a few other shiny ones out there too. Something's going to quit on you, your back, your kidneys. Something will quit as long as you insist upon carrying the burden. The scripture says, cast your care on him. He cares for you. By the way, that's restated in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. You know verse 8, it says, be sober, be vigilant, for your adversary, the devil, walks around seeking whom he might devour. That's the verse right before it. Cast your care on him. He cares for you. And I like the Old Testament. He has never once let the righteous fall. So that's point number one. What was it? 55:22. Here's number two. Take your hand, look right straight at it, and say this word. In fact, there's two words. It's temporary. It's temporary. How old is your hand? My hand is 66 years old. If the church invites me back 50 years from today to talk to you, how old's the hand going to be? Well, you can figure it out. It's going to be pretty mature. Pretty old. Think it's going to look like that? Not a chance. You know what it's going to look like? This one. This one. Because it's temporary. What's the verse of scripture I have up there? It's in Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, the last three verses. Therefore do not lose heart, though outwardly you are wasting away, but inwardly you are being renewed. How often? Day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us something. He calls it an eternal glory that far outpasses them all. And here's the challenge. So we fix our eyes not upon what is seen, but upon what is not seen. For what you can see is, what's that word? Temporary. But what you cannot see is, what's that word? Eternal. As soon as you get that in your brain and start living like that, life becomes a lot easier. There's nothing permanent. It's all temporary. I miss my left hand a great deal. I used to play the guitar, the piano. Used to love to water ski and snow ski, ride motorcycles. My grandpa called them murder cycles. It's probably pretty close to true with me on it. Life changed so quickly. I really miss my guitar. It was a good friend. I have two boys that play the guitar now, so I can enjoy them. It's all temporary. Nothing permanent until we get to the other side. That's where permanent becomes forever. We need to live our lives like that today. Amen? So what was point number one? 55:22. Number two, it's temporary. Here's number three. Put your hand to your forehead. Do this. You're not saluting me. What are you doing? you're taking a long look. Can you see way out there? That's how you do it, isn't it? Just look way out there. How do you think Jesus got past the moment of the cross? When he looked at the moment of the cross in the Garden of Gethsemane, he said these words, "Father, if there's any way this cup can pass, let it pass." And then he took that long look and he said, "But Father, it's not what I want to do. I want to please your will." I don't have time to talk to you about the will of God. There are several things that God doesn't change. Occasionally he'll change his will, but normally he keeps a normal order of things. But God's will for Jesus to come to earth was one thing, wasn't it? To die for you and for me. As he hung on the cross, what did he say? "Get even with those guys out there, God. You know I don't deserve this." Is that what he said? Well, that's what we would say. He said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." That's called a long look. And that's where he saw you. That's where he saw me. That's how we can be called children of God, as we started our song service today. 1 John chapter 3. It's a great chunk of scripture, the first three verses. We are privileged to be called children of God. Amen?
Amen.
Are you an amen church or just a sit low church? That was a good time to say that's right, amen. So what was point number one? 55:22. Number two, it's temporary. What's number three? We're taking that long. That's how you get through life. Because when the moment of impact happens, everything is blurred. Nothing makes sense. It takes a distant look. You take a few steps back and you can say, "Now I understand. Now I can see how God has worked in this way and in this way and that way." I took physical therapy for 7 years in a hospital, learning to walk, learning to talk, and today I talk with a weakened voice. But if I turn my little switch off right now, to talk with that switch being turned on. I was in Iowa after it was in Louisville, Kentucky for 49 days. And the doctors decided to put a clamp on the right side of my neck, clamp off the right carotid artery, where the aneurysm was up there, to lessen the pressure so I wouldn't have another stroke and live longer. And I don't know what happened, and they don't know what happened, but I quizzed them heavily. I said, "Look, you're going to whittle right next to my voice box. Promise me nothing will happen to my voice." They got so irritated at me, and I was pretty vocal about it. They sent me down the hall to talk to people they had whittled on that week. Everybody that I talked to could talk. I said, "Hey, I'm in." I signed a little form and went into surgery. When I came out, I had nothing. You couldn't hear me 6 inches away. I was ripped. I was pretty angry. I was angry at myself because I trusted them. I was angry at my doctors because they didn't even care. They didn't say we're sorry. I was angry at my God because I had trusted him. You know what? That anger only changed me. Doesn't change anything else. The doctors are who they are. The situation is what it is. My God lives up there. He cares. So I didn't have a voice for so long. The left cord and I, you only have two vocal cords. They look like an upside down V. When you push them together, they get tight. They get higher for tones. The further apart they are, the lower the tone. So mine lays up, my left cord lies in a bow. It does no nerve to pull it tight. And that's the left side. Now the right side, they disconnected accidentally in surgery. So now I have two cords that are far apart, and that's why I sound breathy and whispery, raspy. because I can't get those cords together. And usually if I get a cold at a certain time, those cords will swell up and I sound better. I don't want a cold, ever. I just will not have to do that. So without my little gadget here, this would be not possible. So thank God we live in America where we have little gadgets. This one's an old one, but it works. Those little cheap things that you all wear, they do good for you because you got a voice. But I got to get it right in front of my lip to be able to pick it up. And so this one's old, but it's still, I put a few more quarters in the slot and it still works. Dino, we're ready to go to number four. What time am I supposed to quit again?
An hour.
No, no. I'm going to quit sooner because of my voice. What was point number one? 55:22. Number two, it's temporary. Number three, taking that long, long look. And here is number four. But I want you to, if you're sitting next to somebody, which I see several of you said somebody. If you're not sitting next to somebody, scoot close. Like right over here, you gotta get close. Find somebody to sit next to. There's no excuse for this. Find somebody to sit next to. I want you to put your arm around them. It's legal today, okay? These are legal spaces. Put your arm next to them and tell me, how do you feel? Do you feel warmth? Support? You're sitting alone.
I'm not.
Oh, it works. Now, do you feel warmth? Sure. There's something like a 98.6 next to you that just feels good. That's the way life is to be lived. There's a word in our language, it's called, you may have never heard of it, paraclete. It's not parakeet. You know that word. Paraclete means to walk alongside of another. Para means to be next to something. Paraclete. Who really, 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 really wants to be your friend? Now, Jesus Christ, he's walking with you every step of the way. He says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. That's who our God is. So, just keep holding on to each other. Nobody let loose yet. I know you're tempted, but I want you to feel the good support that you can get, that you can feel. So tell me, if Jesus came to Ladysmith, Wisconsin, where would he spend his time? What would he be doing? I think he would be walking around looking for tears. People that don't have it always made. And he'd be putting his arm around them, so to speak, nurturing them to the goodness of God. He studied the people that followed him. Many of them were not of the higher class. They didn't have it always made. But Jesus cared. He loved. He showed mercy. He showed grace. You want to fill your belly? You look for tears. Those people are moldable, pliable. They will listen. But I guarantee you walk the streets of your town today, you'll find tears. For various reasons. Divorce, child, sickness, death, marriage issues. There are tears out there. You can meet those needs through Jesus Christ. Paraclete, walk along the side of another. Can you do that? Will you do that? That's either a yes or a no. Yeah, you can do that. You can be Jesus to them. Amen?
Amen.
So what was number one? 55:22. Number two, temporary. Number three, the long look. What's number four?
Paraclete.
Snuggle city. Walk alongside of them. There are lots of times when you just need to listen. You don't have to have all the gifted words. You just need to listen. And let the moment happen. There are some moments when words are not appropriate. If you do, you stick your foot in your mouth. You just need to outside of another. You don't have to have all the words to be a minister of presence. Amen? I'm going to stop and sing you a song, let my throat rest just a minute. You know this, you might sing a little bit with me on the chorus. There's a voice calling me from an old rugged tree, and it whispers, draw closer to me. Leave this world far behind, I have new heights for you to climb, and in me a new place you'll find. That's it. For whatever it takes to draw closer to you, that's what I'll be willing to do. And whatever it takes for my will to break, that's what I'll be willing to do. I'll trade sunshine for rain, comfort for pain, that's what I'll be willing to do. For whatever it takes, for my will to break, that's what I'll be willing to do. Listen to these words. Take my houses, take my lands, change my dreams, even change my plans, for I'm placing my whole life in your hand. And if you should call me away to your land so far away, Lord, I'll go and your will obey.
I took therapy for 7 years,
in a hospital, learning to walk, learning to talk, learning to live life. I can't tell you how many times a patient will come in and say, my wife left me. My husband left me. See, that's the way it's going to be. I'm out of here. And my wife told me this story. We were in Louisville, Kentucky when I first went to the hospital. We'd only met the minister at that church one time. We worked a revival with him out in Pennsylvania the year before. So he had a little rapport. He was able to tell her what he thought. You really can't counsel someone till you have rapport with that person or nobody listens. He set her down and he said, you got to decide whether you're in or you're out. Decide today. When we got married, it was for better, for worse, for sickness, for health, till death do us part. That's called commitment. That's the same kind of commitment Jesus has for you, till death do us part. I'll be with you to the end of the age. That's what he said. So we have to count on his words being true, right? You just can't take your Bible and tear out the pieces you like. Let the others go. No, they're all true. They're all righteous. Amen? So we can be confident in one thing, that God has you in mind. When he created you, you are made in his image. That means you are like him, a part of you. Now each of us have a responsibility to conform to his image. That's a daily process. You're not born with contentment. You ever notice that? There's no contentment in diapers. You have to learn to be content. I don't have to talk about that because you know what goes with contentment. The Apostle Paul talked about that quite a bit. I have learned the secret of contentment. Amen. I give anything if I had two hands. A leg that would run doesn't work. My grandkids can walk me to a T. They've seen me walk. They don't have to. They can hear me coming because it's ka-thump. They know when I'm close. I go out. Our daughter Martha has 5 kids under 10. And they live on our town. Well, they live on the edge of town. And I go out there every night when I'm home and I tell them stories. So I got this girl, one of them sneezed right on me, and I said, gotta look that way. But it was too late. So here it is, with a cold. And I'll tell them Ansel and Gretel stories, I tell them real life stories from our marriage, from our ministry, and try to teach them good lessons that they can take with them through life. Planting good seeds everywhere you go. It takes time because I know at 8:30 I've got to be out there. About an hour or so we spend together. Read some Bible together. And they know me pretty well. And I know them pretty well. Investing in family. My ministry is called Real Effective Living in Every Family. Relief Ministries. Real Effective Living in Every Family. When you walk into heaven, guess who you want to walk in with? Your family. So plant good seeds everywhere you go. So let's get back to our talk. What was number one? 55:22. What was number two? It's temporary. Number three? Taking that long look. Number four? Apparently, walk alongside of another. And here's point number five, the last one. How do you spell relief? The last one. Here it is. Take your Bible or pick up a songbook, something. This is a thing you're going to do. I want you to put it right up here, right next to your head. What do you think that signifies? Getting the Word of God into your head? Now slip it down right next to your. What do you think that signifies? It's got to get in your heart to make a change. As long as it stays in your head, it's just good stuff. When it gets down here, changes happen. That's what we have to do in life. get to know the Word of God, and then get it into your head and into your heart. What are some scriptures that have helped you get through life during that moment of crisis? Can you tell me some scriptures you put up here that have helped you? I'm all ears.
Psalm 41.
Which says,
I will cover you with my feathers.
Covering from God that protects you.
Isaiah 57:1.
Which says,
none ponder why the righteous perish. It is despair of evil in this world.
And then somebody else?
Philippians 1:6.
Which says,
being confident of this very thing, that he who began a good works in you will complete it until the day of Christ Jesus.
Yep, he'll complete that task for you all the way. Somebody else? The scripture that has helped you in life.
John 3:16.
Which says,
for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life.
Off of the scripture, we believe God gave and received. John 3:16. Somebody else? The scripture.
All things work together for good. That's
10 words to say it together. I can do. No, it's all things work together for good to those who love God, to those called according to his purpose. Yes. Day one when I got to the hospital, I had my right foot, this scripture put at the foot of my bed. 10 simple words. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now if you analyze that verse, it says, I can do what? All things. How? Through Christ. Why? Because he strengthens who? Me. I read it every day. I can do all things. I'll guarantee you, when you're weak, he'll be strong. When you're down, he'll be up. He's available 24/7. Did you get up this morning and say, I wonder if God's really awake today? Oh, you know he's present. You know he's there. You know he cares. We can be confident of that. You don't have to walk around with a question mark on your forehead. Is God really available today? No, he is. He is. He will always be. To the end of the age, he said. That's going to be beyond me, beyond you. Amen? So let's go through this one more time, and then we'll sing the commitment song. The first point is 55:20. What book is that?
Psalms
55:22. Number two, it's temporary. Number three, long walk. Number four, we'll be in a paraclete, looking for others with tears, walking alongside. Number five, get the word from your head to your heart, and then live with it. Trust it. Do what it says. It's all he has. Amen? So Jesus said in the book of John, unless you believe in me, you're going to die in your sin. In Luke chapter 13, he said, unless you repent, you will perish. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, if you confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father. If you deny me, ditto. I'll deny you. And Jesus said in Mark chapter 16, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Those are not any words other than Jesus Christ works. I don't know where this talk found you today. I hope it found you somewhere. I hope when you leave this room, you'll be one of his. If you're not, this is the moment to change your heart, to become more like him. Obedient. That's what Jesus was. He was obedient even to the point of death. Death on the cross. So we can learn that lesson as well. I walk around with an issue, and it goes with me everywhere I go. I'm used to the stairs. It's the way life is. We're all curious. If I stood up here completely whole with a full head of hair and walking just like you, you would say, I wonder if that really happened. It did. God has left some scars to remind me of his goodness. Amen. Amen. So I want to bring me out here at 9:15, is that right? Will you have a little bit of grace? I would like to sing you one more song. And I want to sing a commitment song. If you start throwing eggs or tomatoes at me, I'll turn it off. It's one of my favorite songs. I just came into a valley, one like I've never been before. It seemed like everywhere I turned, there were padlocks on my door. Oh, there must be another sunrise, another sunset that I'll see. God will make this trial a blessing, that's the love he has for me. God will make this trial a blessing, though it sends me to my knees. Though my tears flow like a river, yet to get this sweet release. There's no need to get discouraged, no need to talk defeat. God will make this trial a blessing, and the whole wide world is see. I was not the first one to come into this place, for you see every child of God that we try as you will face. It is here that God will mold you. He'll make you what you want to be. God will make this trial a blessing. Just be patient and you will see. Now here's some great news. I'm standing on the mountain. Looking back, I can see. When I was at that lowest valley, his strong hand was lifting me. Oh, it's good to see the sunshine and to taste such victory. God will make this trial a blessing. Oh, the grace he gives to me and to you. God will make this trial a blessing. Though it sends me to my knees, though my tears flow like a river, yet in him there's sweet release. There's no need to get discouraged, no need to talk me beat. God will make this trial a blessing, the whole wide world will see. Brothers, consider it pure joy whenever you face trials of any kinds, because you know the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you might be complete, not lacking in anything. And the whole wide world will see. Yes, the whole wide world will see. So let's sing this song a cappella together. You know what I think? The words will be on the screen. Change my heart, oh God. Change my heart, oh God, make it like you. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am your clay. Mold me and what I pray. Change my heart, oh God, make it ever true. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. I trust you'll make that commitment today. If you don't want it is, become one. From the Gateway Singers, I tell you hello, and someday I'll get us. all back up here. This wasn't possible this trip. Thank you for your support of our work. We still represent Jesus everywhere we go. And thank you for making that possible.
Okay, Doug, appreciate your testimony, your sharing, offering the word, and it's all been good for us to hear. And we trust that we can make an application to our the boxes here at the back, we're giving a pre-roll offering to the Relief Ministries, and if you would like to write out a check, they get out to Relief Ministries. That needs to be done just for their bookkeeping records and so on. And Don's going to be at the back, he'll be out there by the display. If you have anything you want to ask him or questions and receive, that's how you can take his music right with you and so on. So let's stand together. Father, we thank you for the Gateway Singers and the ministry they've had over the years. Certainly not free from struggles, complications, but Father, you proved yourself true in allowing that message to go forth through them, regardless of circumstances and situations. And Father, we pray that that would be true for us as a body of believers, as individual believers, just to trust you, regardless of circumstances or situations. Help us to honor you in all things. We'll give praise and glory to you through your Son, Jesus. So we're grateful for this morning. We ask your blessing as we come to a conclusion of the service. And as we enter into another week, may it be one that glorifies your name. Forgive us, Father, for being false.